We're entering a new study today. It's in Hebrew called Masai, the book of Acts, right? The book of Acts is something that the Lord asked me to read when I was in hospital, and I thank God that in 4 days I was able to cover the book of Acts. Very significant study, especially in this time frame, because it talks about prophecy, about a mystery that was to take place. Now, what you have to understand is we have got indoctrination from churches and teachers and many good people who wanted to follow what they were taught, right? But when you have studied the book of Acts the way I have studied it, I don't see it as the book of Acts. I don't see it as the book of Acts. Why do I say that? Because when you look at chapters 1 to 12, 13, you will find that it is mainly focusing on one man, Kepha, Peter. He starts off with a blunder, right? He starts off with a blunder, and I believe he made a spiritual blunder, right? And I will show that to you. He did it in good faith, right? But I believe that he did something which was premature. And then you will find that from Acts 14 onwards, it is the life of a new person who persecuted the Kahilia, the people of the way. The church was not called the church. It's not a building. It's Kahilia in Hebrew, which means the called out ones to worship God. See, prayer works. Now I stopped. Right? The book of Acts is basically a collection of a story about two people. But what a lot of people have not understood, which I want to clarify before, because this is going to be a long teaching. We're going to do it for many weeks. He starts off by saying something, the writer, and from that you can identify who wrote the book of Acts. He starts off and says, "The first account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Yeshua began both to do and to teach." The first account I made. Is he talking about a future tense? No, he's talking about a past tense. In short, the writer of this book wrote something else before. How do I know it? I will prove it to you from the man who wrote this book, the Gospel of Lucas, or Luke, chapter 1. "Since many have indeed taken in hand to set in order an account of matters completely confirmed among us, as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the word delivered them to us. It seemed good to me as well, having followed up all these matters from the beginning, to write to you an orderly account, most excellent Theophilus." This is the same guy who wrote the Gospel of Luke, who is Luke himself, who is now writing the book of Acts. Who is this most excellent Theophilus? This is actually not a human, a name of a person, but it is a title which means lover of God. Theos is the Greek word for God. Theophilus is lover. Lover of God. This and most excellent. You see, we read it in English, but we don't realize that certain terminology in the Hebrew translated into the Greek had profound meaning. Most excellent means this guy was a governor, a Roman governor who was a lover of God. Doesn't that sound profound? As I said, when you read the book of Acts, unless the Holy Spirit really opens it up to you, you will not get this impression, and you will think these are the Acts of the Apostles. It doesn't tell you. What does the book of Acts lack? The main church, the church of Jerusalem. It doesn't tell you anything about it. Except in Acts 15, it tells you about a meeting between Shaul, who came in after 10 years, right, to meet the brethren and to ask them, are you really doing what the Holy Spirit told me to do? It doesn't tell you about the Church of Rome. So it doesn't tell you about two of the main churches. It doesn't tell you what all 11 plus the one that Peter Kepha added, the 12 disciples, what they did. It just gives you briefs, a little bit about some. It tells you one whole chapter, Acts chapter 7. It tells you about Stephen. It redefines who a martyr is. A martyr is not somebody who dies for Christ. A martyr is somebody who has accepted Christ. Right? If you want to know the best insight into what we call the Tanakh, which is paraphrased in one chapter, Acts chapter 7. He gives you a concise insight into the entire Tanakh in one chapter. Nobody can give you a better brief on the Tanakh, or what you and I call the Old Testament, as much as Stephen. So what we have to understand before we get into the book of Acts is that the writer is clearly identified as Luke. He was not a Jew, right? He was a Gentile. He was a doctor. And he was a very learned man in Greek. Very learned in Greek. And what he's actually doing is he's writing an account to a Roman governor. For what reason? You have to understand the historical aspect, then you will understand the book of Acts. What he's actually doing is he has become the writer for somebody who you will find out is Rav Shaul, as a defense lawyer, is putting together a case of how the Messiah came into this world, how he touched the lives of people, how he touched the life of a man who was zealous for God and who started persecuting these people because he had no knowledge of what was the church or what was the final mystery, and then how he had this major meeting with God himself, and how his life was transformed, and then the very people whom he represented, the Jewish zealous community, the Pharisees, how the very people whom he sided with became actually who? The perpetrators. The people who actually persecuted him. You will also find that in every account of Rav Shaul or Luke presenting what Rav Shaul experienced, that the believers were the persecuted, the Jews, the zealous Jews, were the persecutors, right? The people who broke the law, and the people who were the nice guys who came in to help the church or the ecclesia were the Roman soldiers. So he had to be writing to a Roman mindset. Somebody who was shown, listen, you guys who don't know Yeshua, who have no idea of Judaism, right, or the Torah, you guys have actually come in to help us. It is the Jews who don't want to cooperate. They want to come to steal, to kill, and to destroy. They are the ones who are actually breaking the law. With that, let's move on. And it says, until the day that he was taken up, this is talking of Yeshua, after giving instructions through the set apart spirit to the emissaries whom he had chosen, to whom he has also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs. Very strong words. He's saying that this scripture, actually we can use it in today's context, especially in the light of Peace TV that promotes a false religion. He's saying here that the proof the risen Messiah gave was infallible. Now, where do you hear this word infallible? You hear it from the Roman Pope, who claims that every word he speaks is infallible. That is blasphemy in the eyes of God. There is only one who is infallible, the Holy Spirit himself. because he is the spirit of truth. If a man claims to be infallible, he has blasphemed God. And that is why I clearly believe that there is not one pope in heaven, because they have all blasphemed. When you take a title as Pontifex Maximus, which is the Roman title of the high priest in the pantheon of all the Roman gods, that is how you get the name Pontiff, from the Latin word Pontifex Maximus. Maximus is the highest, the high priest of the Roman pantheon. He is also called the vicar of Christ. If you translate that word vicar, it means anti, the Antichrist. Now, my study of the book of Revelation is very clear to me that he is not the Antichrist. He would represent the false prophet. But when you say anti, it also comes from the word pseudo. In short, he is somebody who is posing himself off as the form of God. He is trying to tell the world that he is the mediator between God and man. That's strange, isn't it? Because the word of God says there is one man, and there is one God, and there is one man, the man Christ Jesus, who is mediator. There is one God, and there is one mediator, the man Christ Jesus, or Yeshua. So if Yeshua is the mediator between God and man, who is this guy? False. And that's why it's saying, whatever happened through his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them for 40 days. Here is that account of 40 days. 40 days clearly proves that just like he was in the wilderness, out there being led by the Holy Spirit, he was on earth being led by the Holy Spirit, proving to people everything he taught them in 3 years, that the Son of Man must rise on the third day. That the marks that he bore on that cross, because there's a false religion in this world that says Yeshua was never crucified, that his disciples actually took him off and put somebody else who was dead. This is what this false demonic spirit is teaching. Why do you think the gospel account of that meeting between Thomas and Yeshua was so important, where this false religion, which came in 700 years later, clearly proved as false? He says, come Thomas, you said, I will not believe unless I put my fingers into his wrists and into his side. He said, come. If, according to this false religion that's propagated in the world, says that Yeshua was not crucified on a cross, how come he bears the marks? Please tell me that. You see, that is why Psalm 2 says, he who sits in the heavens laughs. When you try to play God, he sits in the heavens and laughs. Let us move on. And the meeting with them, verse 3, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father. This is so significant. Even the disciples and the apostles came under the strict instructions of Yeshua, who was in obedience to the Father. And he clearly says, I can do nothing except the will of my Father. Now, what does this mean? I said this earlier at the meeting. The Lord has given us a prophetic calendar, fulfilling Genesis 1:14, that he created the stars and all creation for signs and for seasons. In Exodus chapter 12, the Lord appears to Moses and he says, today will be what? The new year, the new season, right? And Leviticus 23 confirms that. So God introduces a calendar to the Hebrew people. It's not a Hebrew calendar, it's not a Jewish calendar, it's not an Israeli calendar, it is God's calendar. But it's revealed first to the Jewish people. They are the custodians of the word of God. Why? Ask God. He knows best. But believe you me, everything that he revealed was revealed mainly to the Jewish nation, which means he really has his eye on them. trust him for being him. What does he do? He gives us a calendar, which is a calendar from heaven. In Hebrew, it's called Moedim, which means my set appointed times. And God will do nothing outside that. So if you're talking about the rapture, if you're talking about the tribulation, if you're talking about anything, it has to fall into this calendar, because this is the date timeline that the Lord God himself set even before the foundation of this world. And that is why after 40 days, he says, wait in Jerusalem until the promise of the Father. Not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which you have heard of me. Because Yohanan truly immersed in water, but you shall be immersed in the set apart spirit not many days from now. How many days was that? 10. 10 days. 10 days. So when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Master, would you at this time restore the reign of Israel? Because the one thing they wanted to know is, when is this all going to happen? Now, everything he told them had really not got into them, because the set apart spirit had still not fallen upon them. They had no understanding that in AD 70, that a diaspora would take place, that the very temple that they were so enamored by would be destroyed. But the Lord was talking about a time when Israel will be back in the nation, where Jerusalem will be back in the hands of the Jewish people, where Jerusalem itself will become a burden stone to the entire world. That is the time that he would come back. And fortunately or unfortunately, all of us in this room are born for a time such as this. We are here because Israel is back in the nation. We are here because since 1967, Jerusalem is back in the hands of the Jewish people. The Kotel is back in the hands of the Jewish people, and they are worshipping Yahweh Elohim every Shabbat. Right? We are at a time where the United Nations almost agreed on a Palestinian homeland. Right? We are at a critical time where the book of Acts is going to explode in our minds. And the church is going to do something where it has never done before. A church that has been anemic in these last few decades, become so anemic, so enamored by the lust of the flesh, the lust of the world. They've got into church buildings. Every church has got a building program. I have not found any scripture in this which tells you to build churches the way they are building churches today. Because the Lord himself said, this beautiful building, according to Matthew 24, that you see will be a pile of rubble. What the Lord wants us to do in the book of Acts, especially in a time such as this, is to build people through spiritual stones. That is his temple. You will find that a third temple will come up very shortly. It will happen. But that temple will not honor the God of Israel continuous. They will make it to honor the Lord God of Israel. They will make temple sacrifices. And you will find that before they can sneeze, the Antichrist will sit there and want people to offer sacrifices to him and to worship him. And that is called the abomination of desolation. But praise God, I believe I'm a pre-tribulation rapture theorist. I believe we will not be here to see that. But the majority of the world will see that. And that's why I say, before the great and awesome day of the Lord, you will see what the prophet Joel spoke in chapter 2 taking place. And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times of the seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power. This is the Greek word dunamis. Dunamis is the power to convert. And that power, dunamis, D-U-N-A-M-I-S, dunamis. Dunamis is the power to convert. To convert what? A small room into a big room? No. One floor into 15 floors?
No.
Non-air conditioned into air conditioned?
No.
1 acre into 3 acres?
No.
Dunamis is the power to bring somebody who is spiritually dead to life. We are going to face a stage very soon where a young believer, maybe 14 or 16 years old, might pray over her aunt who is inside the coffin, and the lady might come back to life. That is the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in these last days. So when you see it happen, praise God. And you shall be my witnesses. And this is the methodology of how the church moved from the church of Jerusalem to the church of Ephesus. You shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem. So the first church is not the Roman Catholic Church. The first church is the church of Jerusalem, which was 100% pure Hebrew Jew. 100%. You know, there are many Roman Catholics who accuse Christians and say, you know, we were the first church. Wow, I didn't know that Jesus was born in AD 325 at the Nicene Council. You see, when you know your scripture, you can take any false religion and split it to your own wishes, because there's only one thing that defines scripture: scripture itself. In Latin, it's called sola scriptatus. Sola scriptatus, scripture only. Where was the Pope? Peter was the first Pope. Then how come James, the blood brother of Yeshua, handles the Council of Jerusalem? How come Paul rebukes Peter? If any man rebukes the Pope today in the church, what do? They excommunicate him. So then Paul should have been excommunicated. Peter was never the first Pope because there is no Pope. There is one body and there is one head, the Lord Christ himself. There is but one God and one mediator, the man Christ Jesus. Go to the book of Ephesians. What does he say when he talks about the husband and the wife? He says, wives, submit to your husbands as what? As what? Sorry? Wives, submit to your husbands as what? As what? As the church submits to Christ. He doesn't say it to anybody else. He is the head. We are the body. And it says, husbands, love your wives as I love the church. So who is the head of the church? He. Why does he say, you know, love your wives as I love the church? Because he's telling husbands, you're going to deal with a very complicated group of people, but just love them anyhow. That's what he's saying. You take the body of Christ. What a complicated group of men and women. And he's saying, it doesn't matter, love them. And he's saying, in that same realm, love your wives because it were come us. Right? And you will be my witnesses from Jerusalem in all Judea, Yehuda, and where? Shamaron, Samaria. So Samaria is a Gentile area. So basically, he's defining how the Holy Spirit will lead his disciples and apostles to take the good news, the Basar, from Jerusalem, church numero uno, church of Jerusalem, to Judea, to Samaria, to Palestine, unheard of. There was no Palestine until AD 125. And who brought that name? Philistina, the Romans. And they are supposed to be the people who uphold the true faith. Lies, lies, lies. There is no Palestine. Never was. Palestine is an area that was created by the Emperor Hadrian in AD 123. He was a Spaniard in the Roman Empire. There is your facts. You want to know the name Palestine? 123 years after Christ was the name Palestine put into that same area. According to the book of Acts, it is Israel, it is Jerusalem, it is Judea, it is Samaria, not Palestine. They know Palestine. So what is this Palestine they are talking about? It's something satanic, it's something political. It is not of God. And let me tell you this, God will not give that land to anybody. Because the day that land is released into the hands of the heathen, God becomes a liar. And God very clearly tells us, I am not a man that I should lie. It will never happen. They can go and see Ban Ki-moon and they can even take him to the moon. They will never get it. They can fire all the rockets from Iran and Gaza and Syria, but they will not get 1 inch of that land. And in their frustration, all the Islamic nations are going to gather together and say, listen, we overthrew various nations in our region. What is this small land? Let's go and get them. Then they will meet the one true living God. That's the day. That's the day. In that same realm. And having said this, while they were looking on, he was taken up and a cloud hid him from their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven, as he went up, see two men stood by them dressed in white. You will always find two angels, because those are the two angels of the Merkaba, the mercy seat. They are called the angels of the resurrection. They are always there. They were there when the Lord died. Right? And you can clearly see from all accounts, no religion can boast of this account. No religion can say that their religious leader, while he was talking to them, was taken up by two angels. Not even the false religion that talks of angels. Think about it. The man died and that was it. They talk of jinns, right? How come the two jinns were not there to take him up to heaven? But the book of Acts clearly, profoundly says that Yeshua, who rose from the dead, who for 40 days was met and spoke to thousands and thousands of people, who had one of his disciples challenge him. The Bible is very clear that there was disagreement, that there was a doubter called Thomas. And he said, I want to poke my fingers, I won't believe. And the Lord appears and says, come, do it. And he was so convicted, he ran away to preach the gospel in India. And that's how you get Indian Christians today. He was so convicted that he had fallen short of the glory of God. But let me tell you this, no religious leader, you can check any religion in the world, no religion will boast that while whoever their religious leader was, when he died, D-I-E-D in capital letters. But when Yeshua HaMashiach rose on the third day, as he prophesied, he said, break this temple and I will rebuild it in 3 days. He rose from the dead. Hallelujah. He appeared to people. He came through walls. He got people to examine them. And 40 days later, as he was talking to them, he rose from the dead to prove to you what Rav Shaul said, that if Christ did not rise from the dead, our faith is in vain. There's no religion in the world that can make that claim. Because Yeshua rose from the dead, so shall you and I rise from the dead. There are people who are waiting to get reincarnated. Yesterday's news, it talks about the Dalai Lama wondering when he's going to die, whether he'll get reincarnated in some other human being. They're waiting to name some other Lama. Let me tell you, Lama or Obama, none of those things will happen. If the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach is not on your spirit, you will go straight to hell. You can choose wear white, wear yellow, wear saffron, put a cap on your head or shave your head, grow a long beard, you will go to hell. And that is the biblical fact. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father except through me. I enter in by the blood of the Lamb. No other way. And as they were gazing up to heaven, he went up. See, two men stood and dressed in white, who also looked and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up into heaven? This same Yeshua, who was taken up from you into heaven, shall come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Nobody can go into heaven if they are not pure. If there's any impurity in them, they can't present themselves to the Father. So Yeshua cannot come back to this earth and say, sorry guys, I had it wrong for over 2000 years. Now you have to follow this new religion. He is God himself in the flesh. And when he comes, the word of God clearly says, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Adonai. He is Melech Melechaim, King of Kings, and Adon Adon, Lord of all lords. He shall come as you saw him go to heaven. And how shall he come? Go back to 700 years, to almost 600 years, to the prophet Zechariah. And Zechariah says what these guys said to the apostles, that on the day he descends from heaven, when his foot touches the Mount of Olives, it will cleave. And that is called the day of the Lord. That final day battle, when he comes back to Jerusalem, to the Mount of Olives from where he left. And I think we have to understand that this is prophecy in the making. The Mount of Olives is not in the hand of the Jordanians. It's in the hand of the Jewish people. And he's coming back to that very same land that all of us have gone to. Bible prophecy is taking place in front of you as you read the papers every day. That is why the book of Acts is so important. Then they went back to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey. When they came in, they went up into the upper room where they were staying, both Kepha, Yaakov and Yohanan, Andre, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, Yaakov, the son of Alphai, and Shimon, the Zealot, and Yehuda, the son of Yaakov. So it's basically telling you the key apostles who were there. All of them were continuing with one mind in prayer and supplication with the woman and Mariam, the mother of Yeshua, with his brothers. Ah, hello, his brothers were there now. The Catholic Church says that he didn't have brothers. That Mariam remained a virgin. I mean, I don't know, after one child, how you can remain a virgin. You can remain a virgin prior to pregnancy. But after you are pregnant, means no virginity. No brothers, no sisters. That's why the word of God very clearly says, her firstborn son. Because there were many others. And here the book of Acts clearly says, right? And they were continuing with one mind in prayer and supplication with the woman and Mariam, the mother of Yeshua, with his brothers. With his brothers. After the Lord rose from the dead and appeared to many, the brothers came back. And that is how his blood brother James takes over the Council of Jerusalem. So as I said, what we are going to see in the book of Acts is going to be a learning curve when we meet Catholics, when we meet people of false religions, to present them the facts, because God has given us a promise in this last dispensation that the glory of the latter house will be greater than the former house. Shall we pray? Father, I give you thanks, I give you praise that, Lord, we have just read 14 verses of the book of Masai, what is called the Acts of the Apostles. Father, thank you that you have spoken to us to edify us and to bring us into queue of the facts of how you established the group that was a mystery to the Jewish nation, called the people of the way, that Lord, in these last days, we will be those people who will go like the apostles and do the great miracles of the latter house. For that is the promise that you gave the prophet Haggai, and that we claim over each one of us in the matchless name of Yeshua HaMashiach. This is how last week we studied the book of Acts. When I said we studied the book of Acts, we began to study the book of Acts. We went into chapter 1 and verse 1 to 14. In that, what did we learn? We learnt about the apostles, right, meeting together, right, just after spending time with the Lord. He had encouraged them to stay. He had been with them for 40 days. And then he says, he encourages them, wait for 10 more days. Why? Because God works on a biblical calendar. And it was 10 more days for the festival of Shavuot. Now the word Shavuot is Hebrew and it means weeks. 7 weeks. 7 into 7, 49 plus the Shabbat is 50. And that's how you get that Greek word Pentecost. Now there are Pentecostal churches. Right? What they are trying to tell you is that they are churches that follow the Holy Spirit. But the word Pentecost does not mean Holy Spirit. The Greek word Parakletos means Holy Spirit. And Pentecost purely means 50 days. There's nothing else. Pentecost does not mean Holy Spirit. But when we recap, we find, right, that what we learned up to chapter 1 verse 14 is that the apostles were in one accord, right? And that they were in what we commonly know today is the upper room. Verse 15, which we are going to start today, of Acts chapter 1. Now in those days, Kepha, and that is Peter in your Bibles, arose among the brethren. Now please understand this, that up to this point, the blood brothers of Yeshua, right, were also in the congregation. We knew that. Because in verse 14, it says, waiting together with the woman and Mariam, the mother of Yeshua, with his brothers. So his resurrection from the dead and his appearance to the people of Jerusalem for 40 days clearly brought in his brothers, and two of them we know was whom? James and Jude. Right? James and Jude. But what you have to understand is they had still not received the Holy Spirit. And that is the only reason why Peter or Kepha took authority, because he was one of the 12. But you will find that in Acts 15, the person who really is in charge of, and I don't like this word, the church, but for argument's sake, let's use the word church, of the assembly, is Yeshua's blood brother, James. So this whole fallacy about Peter being the first pope gets thrown out of the window 15 chapters or 14 chapters later. The head of the church, as far as human beings were concerned, as far as taking decisions on what is sola scriptatus, scripture only, what should be practiced, is not done by Peter. It is done by Yeshua's blood brother, James. Okay? Verse 15. Now on one of those days, Peter arose among the brethren, the whole number who were gathered together, about 120. Now, this 120 basically is the reference to them gathering in what we call the upper room, right? Brethren, he said, it was necessary that the scriptures be fulfilled, which by the Holy Spirit foretold by the lips of King David about Judas. This is Judas Iscariot. Judas Iscariot. Iscariot means the place of Iscariot. It's a place, right? Who acted as a guide to those who arrested Yeshua. For he was counted among us and received by divine allotment his portion in ministry. So what he's saying is that even Judas, who betrayed the Lord, was brought in by Jesus himself, divine appointment. Now this man obtained a piece of land with the money, which was paid. What was that money? It was how many pieces of silver? 30 pieces of silver, right? It was paid to him as a reward for his treachery and wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle of his body and intestines poured out. Now, please understand this. This passage means so much to us on this very day of Yom Kippur. This is amazing that the Lord chose to teach us this passage in the book of Acts chapter 1 on this very day of Yom Kippur. Because on Yom Kippur, there are two goats for the Lord and the Azazel. Okay? And what happens is that the sins that are put on the scapegoat, he's chased out into the wilderness and he's pushed off a cliff. He breaks his neck and his bowels spill out. That is what happens to the scapegoat. Okay. And you will find that exactly on this Hebrew calendar or the calendar of our Lord, Yom Kippur, we are studying the book of Acts and we are coming to the conclusion that in the same way, the sins that was passed on to a goat which was cast out every year on Yom Kippur is happening here in Acts chapter 2. It's amazing. And all the residents of Jerusalem being acquainted with the facts, so they called the place of land in their own dialect Akeldama. Akeldama means the field of blood, which is also called the potter's field. Akeldama to this date has been a place where, according to the temple, that money of 30 pieces they could not take in because it was blood. So what did they do? The Jews are amazing people. They love money more than anything else, sometimes more than God. So the priest took a decision. Listen, every time a stranger comes into the land and dies, we have to use temple money to bury the guy because you can't leave a dead body. So they bought this piece of land, right? And the amazing thing is the potter's field, this field of Akeldama, is right down in the precipice from the cliff where Judas Iscariot hung himself. It's amazing. It's amazing God's humor. So that everybody who passes by this field of blood, Akeldama, will look up to the mountain and say, that's the guy who paid for it. Some humor, isn't it? But it's very clear that the scriptures prove it. In the book of Psalms, it is written, let his place of residence become deserted and gloomy, and let there be no one to live in it, and let another take his position. This is from Psalm 69:25 and Psalm 109:8. So basically the psalmist is seeing this in the future and he's saying that one will have to live. And I believe if anybody goes down to hell, not for your sins, but if the Lord takes you down there, that you will find Judas in a place in hell of total isolation. Because the psalmist is saying that. And it also says that one should replace him. So, of the other men who have accompanied us during this time, that the Lord Yeshua went in and out of us. From the baptism of Yohanan or John, outset until the day when he was taken up from among us, one of these men must join us and become witnesses to testify to his resurrection. The one purpose of the kingdom of God, as far as the book of Acts is concerned and what we call the beginning of the church of Yeshua, is to be ministers not of the gospel, but to be ministers of the resurrection. If you take every religion of the world, they will teach you that you have to treat people well. that there has to be tolerance. In Sri Lanka, they use a word called Maitri, right? There is no Maitri from the people I have met. But they talk of this, you know, compassion, mercy, to fast, to do good to others. But what does the minister of the gospel of Yeshua HaMashiach have to say? As the Lord rose from the dead, as it is appointed by Yeshua himself, it is for man to die once and then the Bema Seat. Hebrews chapter 9. We can only present the resurrection because it is for all men to die once. And if the blood of the sacrificial Lamb of God is not on your head, you will face the second death. Revelation chapter 20 is very clear that a time will come that those who have died and who are not in Christ will go through another 1,000 years called the millennium. Millennium is basically two Greek words put together. Mil is 1,000 in Greek and annum. Mil annum. Millennium. That's how you get that word millennium. Right? It's two Greek words. And those who are in Messiah will actually be transformed or translated and come back and rule and reign with him. And that is the promise that even the Jews who did not know Christ believed in, that one day they shall rise from the dead. Take the resurrection out of Christianity and we are just another religion. Islam doesn't have it. Buddhism is a philosophy. It's not a religion. Hinduism, I don't know what they promise you. Right? They say that immediately after death, after they cremate you, you have to come and see whether there's a footprint on your grave. Am I correct? And if it's a crow, then you have become a crow. If a dog happens to go past that way, then you become a dog. I mean, gee whiz. You know? So, you know, all these fallacies. But the one thing that the apostles took with them is that Yeshua rose from the dead, so shall we. And Shaul, writing to the church in Corinth, he said, if Yeshua did not die and rise from the dead, our faith is in vain. The one thing that we hold is whatever trials, and I'm telling you, whatever trials we are going through is nothing. It's nothing. Whatever we go through in the name of the Lord, you will be rewarded. No 70 virgins. But what he has for you, the word of God says, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, mind has no comprehension of the things the Father has for those who have received the Son. Amen. Those who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. But please remember, there's a huge difference between salvation and earning crowns. There's no crown for salvation. There are crowns for those who confess the name of the Lord, who confess the resurrection. One day I will call all men unto me. Please remember that. That is his promise. Verse 23. And they in accordingly proposed, nominated two men, Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was surnamed Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, you Lord, you know all the hearts and thoughts and passions and desires and appetites. Indicate to us which one of these two you have chosen, and to take the place in this ministry to receive the position of an apostle. Now basically, what is an apostle? An apostle is not some guy who walks around the church with a cane in his hand saying, bow before me. An apostle is basically a messenger. A messenger of the news that Yeshua, his salvation in Hebrew, is the only way, and he is the Mashiach, the Messiah that God spoke about in the prophets. And he is the first of all men to rise from the dead. That was their message. That the Torah was fulfilled in him. There is nothing to be fulfilled beyond in the Torah. What Moses spoke about in the book of Deuteronomy, that there will be a prophet like unto me, has been fulfilled, and now he has risen from the dead and he will come back. We learned that last week. He will return. So they drew lots between the two, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to and counted with the 11 apostles who are special messengers. Now please understand this. I, in my personal opinion, and I'm not quoting scripture, believe that, see, if you study the life of Kepha, of Peter, you will find that he had one problem. He had a disease called foot and mouth. He put his foot more into his mouth than any other human being. He did everything that Jesus must be saying, oh, Peter, why did you do this? He put his feet into his mouth more times than anybody else. And I believe he did that here. I really believe he did it here. Because if you take a study of the book of Acts, as I've told you, the book of Acts is not the book of the Acts of the Apostles, right? It basically talks of two people, Peter and then later Saul. And I believe that 12th position in the mind of God was reserved for Rav Shaul, who would come in and take over from Acts chapter 14. Because after this appointment of Matthias, you never hear of him. You never hear of him. So I really believe that Judas's position would then be reserved for Rav Shaul. But Peter goes and appoints Matthias, and you will not find anything about Matthias thereafter. Okay, now you will find that 11th century Archbishop of Canterbury, right? He is the guy who came and thought he'd make the scriptures a bit more interesting, right? And he, what he did was he put in chapters, right? He's the guy in the 11th century who put chapters into the Bible to make it easier for us. So what we are going to see as chapter 2 is actually a continuation of chapter 1. It's as simple as that. But there is a shift now. When the Holy Spirit points out to us certain things like the day, the hour, he's saying, boom, the bulb should light up and say, he's trying to tell us something. It says, and when the day of your Bible will say Pentecost, the Jews never had a day called Pentecost, they had a day called Shavuot. It is the Greek word here for 50 days, that's all. So there is no celebration of Pentecost, there is a celebration of Shavuot. Right? Last night, I asked the group, what is the difference between Hallelujah and Alleluia? What is the difference, Sudarshan, between Hallelujah and Alleluia? One is Sinhalese. Hallelujah comes from the Hebrew word Hallel, to proclaim aloud the name of Yahweh. Hallel. Hallel Yah. Yahweh. Alleluia is the Greek translation of Hallelujah. That's the word. So you will get a Hallelujah in some, you will get Alleluia in some. One is Hebrew, one is Greek. Simple as that. And it says, when the day of Shavuot had come, they were all assembled together in one place. Now we've done this study, but I'm going to re-emphasize this. They were together in one place, and it was not the upper room. It was not the upper room. And I will prove it to you. 99.9% of the Western churches are saying they were in the upper room, and you have this big table and you have a dove on top and you have fire, right? Greek minds. Let's look at scripture. When suddenly there came a sound from heaven like a rushing of a violent tempest blast, and it filled the whole house. Now, because it's a house, doesn't mean it's a cottage. It's the house of God. And scripture will prove it to you. In which they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues of fire resembling fire, which separated and distributed and settled on each one of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit. By the way, there's no Holy Ghost. There's Casper, the friendly ghost in comics, but there is no Holy Ghost. This is stupid Americanism. Get this out. Ghosts are demonic spirits. God is not a demonic spirit. He is Kadosh. He is holy. And He is the Ruah, the breath of God. There is no ghost in God's kingdom except demons. You know, I get mad with these American priests. You know, the Holy Ghost told me. There's no Holy Ghost. He is holy. He is to be revered. And He is the Ruah. He is the breath of the living God. And we, in English, should refer to Him with the same reverence as the Father and the Son as the Holy Spirit. There are no ghosts, American guys. It really infuriates me when I hear this, you know, the Holy Ghost. Who wants a touch of the Holy Ghost? There's no Holy Ghost. It's the Holy Spirit. Please understand, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. He is holy, and He is holy, and He is holy. Please, you know, it really sometimes really infuriates me with this Americanism of 200 years. I mean, they know it all, guys, you know, hamburgers and all. I'm sorry, but the God we worship is a Hebrew God. He is holy, and you don't play the fool with those names. Okay? And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in, now they're here again. They started speaking in foreign languages. They did not speak in tongues. Please get it right. You know, I was a new Christian and I used to hear, oh, they spoke in tongues. Please understand what you are saying. If they spoke in tongues, how come other guys, right? Listen to this. They started speaking in other languages. Please get that. They started speaking in other languages. Now there were residing. Now here's again. As I said, you know, this will clearly prove to you that they were in the temple. If there were 120 in the upper room, believe you me, it was called jam-packed. Sardines. Now there were other people also there. How can other people come into the upper room? What were they doing there? Must be like Sri Lankans, Nikan in now. Just watching. Now there were residing in Jerusalem Jews, devout and God-fearing men from every country under heaven. How many countries do you think were represented there? Sorry? 70. 70. There were men from 70 nations. Okay. And when this sound was heard, there were thousands of people in the upper room, right guys? The walls broke down. They were in the temple, there were thousands. Because later on, Kefa says, this is only the third hour. What is the third hour? The morning oblation, the morning sacrifice. So there were thousands of Jews from 70 nations. It was Pentecost, it was Shavuot. They were there according to Deuteronomy 16:16. Three times a year, all males shall appear before me without but and not empty-handed. So they were there at that time. They were in one accord because it was 9 o'clock in the morning. It was the morning sacrifice, and that's why they were all assembled in one place. And that's why they all heard this rush of the wind, and they heard these 120 Galileans speaking in their languages, and the word of God is clear on them. They were not in the upper room. And they were beside themselves with amazement, saying, are not all these talking Galileans? Then how is it that we hear each of us in our own particular dialect which we are born? And then it gives you the breakdown. There were Parthians. Now the first group of people are the most interesting. The Parthians. These are the people that came under Daniel's influence in the Medo-Persian Empire. And this group is exclusive because they were a kingdom of priests, a royal priesthood. These are the Parthians. And when they were following the Torah, they knew about the prophecy in Numbers chapter 24 about the Bar Koba, the shining star, and they were looking at it year after year. So when the Parthians came, they were a group of kings and priests, and three guys didn't get onto three camels and wander in the desert. A whole army followed them. That's why Herod freaked out. If Herod saw three mangy camels and three mangy Parthians on it, he wouldn't have bothered about it. The Parthians were the most fearful army that even the Romans didn't want to mess around with. And these were converts to Judaism through the prophet Daniel. How many years ago? 600 years before. These were from the Medo-Persian Empire, the Parthians. And here, the Parthians and the Medes. Here you are. Here's your Medo-Persian Empire. Right? Elamis. By the way, these are not Tamils, huh? Okay? These are guys from that region. And it happens of Mesopotamia. Right? Judea. Cappadocia. Pontus. The province of Asia. Pergia. Pamphylia. Egypt. Parts of Libya. And about Cyrene. Right? Residents from Rome, both Jews and proselytes. Proselytes are people from other religions who had converted to Judaism. So all of these people were not there by happenstance. They were there because it was the festival of Shavuot, the Feast of Weeks, and they were there at the ninth hour to worship God because the morning sacrifice was on. Very, very simple. I mean, if all these guys got into the upper room, it would have been become a lower room. Because the place would have blown apart. There were thousands there. Now, let's go to this point of them speaking in tongues. Because scripture has to prove scripture. Amen? So turn with me quickly to 1 Corinthians 14. Eagerly pursue and seek to acquire this love, right? And earnestly desire and cultivate the spiritual endowments or gifts, especially that you may prophesize, interpret the divine will, and inspired preaching and teaching. For one who speaks in an unknown tongue speaks not to men. So how could you be speaking in tongues and all these guys from Parthia to Egypt to Rome understood? The word of God very clearly says, but to God no one understands or catches this meaning, because the Holy Spirit, he utters secret truths and hidden things, but on the, so it's very clear. When you speak in tongues, you are not speaking to Parthians and Pamphylians and Cretans and Greeks, and you are speaking in their language. But when you speak in tongues, you speak to Yahweh Elohim. Very, very clear. So can you see how people have misinterpreted scripture? And all of us say, yeah, they spoke in tongues, you know. I mean, then that means there's an oxymoron, no? It's an oxymoron. He says one thing and does something else. Can't be, you know, scripture has to confirm scripture, right? Then there were Cretans, Arabians, right? And all speaking in their own native tongues, telling them of the mighty works of God. So each one of these guys who had come with their sacrifice at 9 o'clock in the morning, heard these Galileans speaking in their own languages, and they were like, wow man, how can this be? And all beside them were amazed and were puzzled and bewildered, saying to one another, what can this mean? But there were others. Now, in addition to these thousands, there were others also there. Now the upper room gets even bigger. They must have had movable partitions. Every time others came in, they moved that partition. It's the temple. But others made a joke of it and deservedly said, they are simply drunk and full of sweet, intoxicating wine. Must have been some Sri Lankan Christians. The critical part. These guys are drunk. But Kepha, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them and saying, you Jews and all you residents of Jerusalem. So who are the accusers here? The Jews in Jerusalem. Let this be explained to you, so that you will know and understand and listen closely to what I have said. For these men are not drunk, as you imagine, for it is only the third hour. Why does the Holy Spirit say third hour? Because it's 9 a.m. in the morning, and 50 days before that, at this very hour, Yeshua was tied to the cross. 9 a.m. in the morning, the third watch. But instead, it is the beginning of what was spoken through the prophet Joel. He's talking about the prophecy of Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, God declares, that I'll pour out my spirit upon all mankind. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, right? And your old men shall dream. Why old men shall dream? Because old men sleep more than young men. So they're more likely to see dreams. Right? Okay. Yes, and on my maidservants and all those of my men servants and maidservants, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy, predicting the future events pertaining especially to God's kingdom. The main thing about this passage is this is confirming that a time has begun, something which is a mystery according to Ephesians chapter 3 to the Jewish people, that in the latter days God would pour out his spirit on all men, Jew and Gentile, and that what is called the Soreg in Hebrew, the Soreg was the partitioning wall outside the temple where Gentiles could only come up, that he was going to take that out and all of them could come in and worship God, the tabernacle of David, which Acts chapter 15 talks about. Now, what you have to understand is this is key in what we call something that in the mystery, in the mind of God, was now revealed. The mystery was now completed. For the first time, the outpouring of the latter rain was taking place. Not the former rain, but the latter rain. It was poured out on people, and he was adding in people who were believers in Yahweh, but who had come from Gentile nations. The Arabians were Arabians, right? They were not Jews, but they were worshippers of Yahweh. And they were the foundation of what we call the body of Christ. I don't like this word church. Because the moment you say church, somebody wants to put 15 floors and put a building and a name. No. A body of believers. This is the mystery. Right? Now, quickly turn to Haggai chapter 2. Right? And verse 9. Because this prophecy is now moving. It's now moving. Haggai the prophet says, the latter glory of this house. Now, here's the word house again. So, it can't be the upper room. Right? To which, right, Yeshua came, says the Lord of hosts, right, Adonai Sabaoth, and in this place I will give prosperity, says the Lord of hosts. So the glory of the latter house is going to outshine the glory of the former house. It's very simple. In short, what the Lord was saying is, the temple sacrifice is going to end, because I have become that sacrifice, and you are going to be a living temple with the Holy Spirit coming upon you, and you are going to go out into the world and do what verse 19 says, and I will show wonders in the sky above, signs on the earth, blood and fire, smoke, vapor, the sun shall be turned. Now he's giving you what the prophet Joel talked about, Jacob's troubles. So actually there's two parts to it. First stage is I will pour out my spirit on all men. The glory of the latter house will be greater than the former house. And that will then follow the end times. Do you get it? The end times cannot begin until the Holy Spirit pours himself out on all men, men and women, and that they shall start going and doing miracles, prophesying, and announcing the glory of God, especially about the resurrection. That is the uniqueness of Christ to the whole world, and then the end shall come. That's basically it. So he's actually giving you a snapshot of what is going to happen from the time of the day of Shavuot, and he's also snapshotting what's going to happen in the year, the 21st century. Okay? And it concludes by actually him quoting Joel chapter 2, 28, and it shall be that whoever call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is not a quote from Acts. This is a quote from Joel chapter 2 verse 28. He's quoting that in the latter days. Why the latter days? Because when the Lord showed the prophet Daniel, he says these are the kingdoms, the four kingdoms, and what will happen to your people in the latter days. So this is all a part of that fulfillment. So what are we looking at? We are looking at a time where there's going to be the move of the body of Christ followed by the tribulation. And what is the tribulation? The tribulation is basically what is spoken about in the Tanakh. And I don't like this word Old Testament, because there's nothing old about the Old Testament. It's more new than the New Testament. Right? There's more about the Millennium Kingdom in the Tanakh than in the Brit Hadad Hashad. But he's giving you a snapshot. And that is what prophets see. They see the present and they see the future all in one picture. It's as simple as that. So what he's saying is, when you see this move, which is taking place now in front of your eyes, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, you will know that the latter days have begun. When is it going to end? When the fullness of the Gentiles are complete. That is another stage in the part of God's end time plan. It's not a fulfillment, it's only a stage. Right? Last night, I clearly proved to you from five different passages that the rapture of the church is a pre-tribulation rapture. There are minimum of five scriptures to prove that. Right? But let's get into this. That who will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You men of Israel, listen to what I have to say. Yeshua HaNazareth, Jesus of Nazareth, a man accredited and pointed out and showed forth and commanded and attested to you by God, by the mighty works, performing wonders, signs, which God worked through him in your midst, you yourselves know. This Jesus, when delivered up according to defined and fixed purpose and settled plan, and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and put out of the way, killing him by the hands of lawless and wicked men. See, what you have to understand is, there is a place on the Temple Mount called the place of the hewn stone. The place of the hewn stone is where the Sanhedrin was supposed to meet to pass judgment. This place had been abandoned in the time of Yeshua by the Sanhedrin. So basically what the people who put Christ to death was a kangaroo court under the guise of the hewn stone. So basically they had broken Torah for starters. And broken the law by passing this judgment. That's why he said, you crucified him, right? But God raised him up. That's why it says by the hands of lawlessness. You see, we think lawlessness is rowdyism. No, lawlessness comes from those who break Torah. Lawlessness means you have broken the law. What law is this? The 613 mitzvot. That's this lawlessness. The laws appointed to judge people. It's very clear. It's very clear how you judge people. The book of Leviticus is very clear how to pass judgment, how to analyze. What he's talking about here, what a lot of Christians don't understand, is he's talking about the place of the hewn stone, which was not present at the time they passed this judgment. It was a hurried thing because the two high priests, there were two, Ananias and Caiaphas, they wanted Yeshua out of the way because they felt that their own positions were compromised. Very, very simple. It was a personal political position and nothing to do with God. And then he says, but God raised him up, liberating him from the pangs of death, see that it was not possible for him to continue to be or to be controlled or retained by it. For David says in regard to him, I saw the Lord constantly before me, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken or overthrown or cast down. Therefore my heart rejoiced and my tongue exalted exceedingly. Moreover, my flesh also will dwell in hope, right, and dwell in hope of anticipation of the resurrection. For you will not abandon my soul, leaving it helpless in Hades, the state of departed spirits.
nor let your Holy One know decay or see destruction of the body. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will enrapture me and in your presence. Brethren, it is permitted to me to tell you confidently and with freedom concerning the patriarch David, that he both died and was buried, and this tomb is with us today. In short, he's saying David died and is buried, and the tomb is still there. Right? He was also waiting for the resurrection. Being, however, a prophet and knowing that God had sealed to him with an oath that he would set one of his descendants on his throne. Now, this has not taken place as yet. Please understand, this is very critical. When you meet Christians from the major evangelical churches that teach you what is called restructuralism or replacement theology, what they are saying is that God lied in Luke chapter 1 and in the book of Acts and to David. God makes an oath, a ketubah, right, a covenant, that David's descendant will sit on his throne in Jerusalem. Has it happened? It hasn't. So replacement theology is a lie, because God has to fulfill everything that he has spoken. And he will come back in the millennium reign. He will sit on David's throne and he will rule over the Jewish people, not over the church or the body of Christ. He has to fulfill that prophecy for 1,000 years. And the millennium has got to do with all of this, right? In 2 Samuel 7:12 to 16 and Psalm 132 verse 11. It's a promise made by God. He, foreseeing this, spoke of the resurrection of Christ the Messiah, that he was not deserted in death and left in Hades, nor did his body know decay. Look at Psalm 16 verse 10. This Jesus, this Yeshua, raised up out of all that we disciples are willing witnesses. Therefore, being lifted high to the right hand of God, having received from the Father the promise and the blessings, which is the Holy Spirit, he has made his outpouring, which yourselves both see and hear. And he concludes by saying, for David did not ascend into the heavens, yet himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand and share my throne. So he's saying it's not David who sits at the right hand of the Father, it is Yeshua whom David was prophesying about. So it's very, very clear when we study the book of Acts that there are biblical facts that we as believers should come to know. And the majority of Christians don't know this. Can you see how much we've learned in just 2 chapters? So profound. But God is working to a pattern because he's spoken to it through the prophets. Everything. What does Amos chapter 3 verse 7 say? Yahweh will do nothing without confirming it to his prophets first. Everything that God does, he tells it to his prophets first. Deuteronomy 29:29 says, the secret things of the Lord our God belong to him, but the revealed things belong to us and our children's children forever, that we may follow the Torah. It's very, very clear. God will do nothing outside his plan, outside his calendar. So I think what I've taught you today is far more profound than what we taught last Shabbat. Yes? So let's pray. Father, we just give you thanks. We give you praise, Lord, for that power that you preach to us with, Lord. That you convicted us, Lord, of what the scrolls talk about. Father, we thank you that the outpouring that the prophet Joel saw 600 years before you came. And now, Lord, that makes it almost 2,600 years. Father, that the glory of the latter house is happening as we speak. And it's going to be more powerful than the glory of the former. Father, we give you thanks, we give you praise, and we worship you, Yeshua. Because we know, Father, that the final dispensation is taking place as we speak on this day of Yom Kippur. We give you thanks, we give you praise in Yeshua HaMashiach's name. Amen. This is how the Lord asked Aaron to bless the people. Ivarekaka Adonai Vishmareka ඒ අඩුනයි පනිවිලක විහුණු ලෙක ඉස අඩුනයි පනිවිලක විශ්ෂම් ලෙක ශලෝම්. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance and give you His shalom. Go in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach.